The Richmond Red Devils, the Mt Vernon Marauders, the second game of our doubleheader leading to tonight's final. Brebeuf is in. Richmond and Mt Vernon want to play them. The thing about it is that they got to get to Allen Henderson at one point. They'll try to do so tonight. First of all, let's talk about this Mt Vernon Marauders team. They come in led by some big men, and it starts with none other than Chad Kleine, Gary Donna.
Well, Chad is an excellent ball player. He's going to be attending Bradley University. He's a good rebounder, as you see, by averaging almost 9 points per game. He's averaging almost 20 points per game, shooting very well from the free throw line and from the field. So his stats are good, but he's also a good hard-nosed player and a smart player. He does all the right things. He gives senior leadership, and he's half of their twin towers from the Mt Vernon Marauders. The other half of that twin tower combination is Brian Gilpin. He'll be number 50. He averages 11 points and almost 8 rebounds. Also a good shooting percentage around the bucket, and also 61% from the foul line.
And also an early recruit by Bob Knight, the Indiana Hoosiers. He's a junior, and he does the things defensively, as you mentioned. But offense also comes from the Mt Vernon Marauders in other fashions. One of them is Kevin Browning, number 21, 12 points plus a game.
Well, he's only a junior, and he's an excellent athlete, and he really gives some perimeter punch, which the Marauders need, so people can't pack it in on Kleine and on Gilpin. You see, he shoots 52% from the field, 70% from the line. When you consider he's a perimeter shooter, that 52% is very impressive, and his 70% free throw shows you that he can knock it in from the 15-foot stripe.
And then when we move over to the Richmond Red Devils, they get a lot of their offense from number 30, Robert Sanders, 19 points per game.
Well, Robert's only a junior, so he's only going to keep getting better. He rebounds, he gets over 6 rebounds per game, and you see that his shooting percentage and free throw percentage is also very impressive. He also has good quickness and is a good jumper, so he does a lot of things for Coach George Griffin.
As do the cousins, Billy and Brad. Started with Brad Wright. He does a lot of things right.
Well, they have a lot of quickness. They're also good jumpers. This Richmond team is not a big team, but they play bigger than they are because they jump so well, and they have excellent quickness. The Wrights both average in double figures, and also Wright 8 assists per game. That's very impressive. He gets the ball to other people.
Billy and Brad, watch for them. We're ready to listen to the starting lineup. So let's turn it over to our public address announcer, Mr. Ed Watson.
Here are the starting lineups for today's second game. First, for the visitors, the Richmond Red Devils. First to non-starters, number 10, Jackie Bledsoe. Number 20, Chad Austin. Number 34, Trail Kelly. Number 42, Rob Zinken. Number 44, Alex Graff. Number 50, Chris Warfel. Number 52, Lewis Alexander. And now the starters. At one forward, a 5'10 senior, number 22, Brad Wright. At the other forward, a 6'3 junior, number 30, Robert Sanders. Starting at center, a 6'9" freshman, number 40, Jared Powell. Starting at a guard, a 5'9" 11th grader, number 12, Billy Wright. The other guard, a 6'3" senior, number 24, Rob Frazier. And now for the home team, the Mt Vernon Marauders. First to non-starters, number 10, Mike Carter. Number 12, Jeff Boyle. Number 20, Chris White. Number 30, John Harvey. Number 32, Dave Petersball. Number 42, Mark Barnett. Number 44, Lincoln Chapel. And now the starters. At one forward, a 6'1 junior, number 21, Kevin Browning. At the other forward, a 6'8 senior, number 40, Chad Kleine. Starting at center, a 6'11 junior, number 50, Brian Gilpin. Tyler Huffman.
Gary, no secret what's going to happen here. The Richmond Red Devils have speed and balance. The Mount Vernon Marauders have size. It's contrasting styles extraordinaire.
Well, you could almost call them the Richmond running Red Devils because they get up and down. However, in the middle, they have a freshman. And although he's a good one, he's still a freshman. And he's going to be going against some tall timber inside for Mount Vernon and Kleine and Gilpin. And they're upperclassmen. They're junior and seniors. So it's a pretty formidable task for freshman Jared Powers, but he'll have help from Robert Sanders and from Frazier and the Wright cousins, so we're going to see what it's going to be. If it's an 84-foot basketball game up and down, look for George Griffith's Richmond Red Devils to handle that pretty well.
Yeah, they like the fast break. They live and die by the press. Richmond, it's an away team. They're the visitors. They're in the red jerseys, the Red Devils as they are. And they'll try to run and gun quickly. Philly Wright won't get the shoot as well. Gilpin can't get the rebound. Back up Jared Powers. Yes, and a foul.
Well, Jared Powers answers the question, is he intimidated by Gilpin and Kleine? No way. He went right up there and got that ball. We're going to take a look at it. There it comes off the board. Good timing. Grabs the ball, wrestles it away, and goes up strong. An excellent move for the young freshman there inside, and that's got to be a good sign for George Griffith, and particularly Red Devils. It took him about 6 to 7 seconds to get up that first shot.
Brian Gilpin gets called for the foul, and completing the three-point play is the freshman, Jared Powers. And there's the press. We'll see it all day long.
Richmond runs on offense, and they run on defense.
It's Loyola Marymount, as the coach has said before. And now you look for the half-court game. You look for the tempo on Mount Vernon for those watching at home. Look for them to try to go to the big net, like this one. But they'll kick it back outside. Huffman for three. Off the mark. Rebound Richmond. Rod Frazier foul underneath. Traveling. Turnover quickly.
He shuffled his feet. He wanted to get going, but he had nowhere to go, and he shuffled his feet and got good call by the referees.
3-0 quickly in the basketball game. Mount Vernon looking to get on the scoreboard.
Now, viewers got to watch these perimeter people. They're very important for Mount Vernon.
Gilpin off the rebound. He misses. Rebound Richmond.
Huffman, Browning, and Shank. Very important on the perimeter for Mount Vernon to hit outside to loosen up the inside.
Look at Richmond taking the shot again quickly, fighting for the rebound inside the Red Devils, and they come away with it. Sanders has got it. He stops from 11 and gets it. Robert Sanders gets his first bucket. It's 5-0, 6:52 in the first quarter.
I'll tell you what, Mike, Richmond's like five lightning bugs in a jar. They're bouncing off the walls. They're jumping. They're lighting up out there defensively and offensively.
Tempo and control is important for Mount Vernon. Coach said, if we're up in the 80s and 90s, forget about it. And this Richmond team shows that pressure right there. Mount Vernon will get on the scoreboard. Mount Vernon from number 11, Alex Swain. Off the mark and a foul. Shank gets the first two of the night for the Mount Vernon Marauders. And we talked about that, and in talking to the coaches, there is a definite contrasting style. We look at the foul right here, Gary.
A little reach over there on the shot. That foul goes to Chad Kleine on the reach in on the shot, and Chad's got his first, and Chad hasn't done much offensively yet, but keep your eye on those two big fellas inside. Once again, you got two games going. You got the perimeter, and then you got Kleine and Gilpin inside, much like the Brebeuf game where you had Henderson inside.
Yeah, and Frazier will go to the line. He shoots 82%. And gets the first. 24 turnovers forced a game by the Richmond Red Devils.
Frazier's a 6'3 senior, and he's listed as a guard, but he can go inside and get up in the air. He has good quickness and good leaping ability. And also a nice touch to free throw line.
Two times so far today.
And I didn't jinx him.
I was letting you do it. I didn't want two phone calls back at the station.
Well, let's watch Huffman and Shank and Brown. Let's see if they can loosen things up inside for Kleine and Gilpin.
They try to do so. Inside, exactly what you talked about, Gary Don. Chad Kleine.
Chad Kleine's really a smooth player, I tell you. He's going to be a good one at Bradley.
3-point lead for the Richmond Red Devils. As I mentioned, they are in the red. Mount Vernon in the white.
Mount Vernon's in a
his zone and gets some pressure.
Back to Huffman. And he's hammered in a foul. The foul's going to be on Brad Wright, number 22.
Nice steal by Huffman. He comes down, goes up strong, goes to the hoop, draws the foul. Not a bad foul by Wright because it eliminates the three-point play possibility. Just got a quick look at Jimmy Howell and George Griffith. Two excellent basketball coaches, very well respected throughout the state, both very successful at their respective schools.
Lewis Alexander has entered the game for the Richmond Red Devils. At the line is Roger Huffman. Huffman gets the first. Roger Huffman was the most valuable player of that Newcastle Regional. He's the guard that makes things happen, four assists. He's the one who, if you look for somebody to shoot the three, will do so. And gets them both to fall. So Huffman's got two, and we've got a one-point basketball game with 5:40 remaining in the first quarter. This one will be a fun one to watch, and it has been thus far. In and out, back in, no, rebound still underneath. And finally falls for Brad Wright, his first field goal.
Tell you what, you got some real jumping jacks out there in red uniforms for the Richmond Rebel Devils. They get up and they just don't go up once. They keep going up.
Coach Griffith said they'll go 90. They're well balanced. They get the turnover right there. They forced, as I mentioned, 24 turnovers a game. That's an amazing statistic.
And that one they didn't force. Chad Kleine didn't show very good judgment there trying to go behind his back. There was really no reason to go behind his back. And he traveled, so he's a little bit better basketball player than that.
Richmond has the edge, 2-1 in turnovers, as you saw. Right. Now I'm going to have to do this. Brad and Billy again, aren't I? Back to Carl and Corey Reeder, Gary.
Yep.
Brad and Billy Wright. By the end of the day, I may just say Brad and Billy, for you folks at home, those are the Wright cousins, not brothers.
You can't even say BW, just like CR, Corey and Carl.
You got it right. Right, Lewis Alexander.
So Richmond continues to swarm and play a man-to-man defense, go after people, although the fact they might drop back into the zone. They did, they just change defenses. They're in the zone on the out-of-bounds play, but that doesn't bother Chad Kleine. He gets the ball in the paint and drops it in.
Kleine with a 10-footer. He's got four. Answering quickly back. Richmond tries, took a rebound. Huffman puts it on a fast break. Huffman pulls up and hits the jumper. It's off the mark, though. Rebound Mount Vernon, and Richmond will have a held ball, not a jump, and the possession will point the way up the Mount Vernon Marauders.
Well, Mount Vernon, one of the, that time they chose to run, they had the break. Huffman was out in front, pulled up and took the jumper. It wouldn't go. It hit off the back rim, as you mentioned, and Mount Vernon retains possession.
Chad Austin, the sophomore guard, 6'1", entering the game for the Richmond Red Devils. Now, we talked a little bit to George Griffith about his team this year, and he says it truly is a team, and that he likes. He likes the fact that they are a team out there, team being the key word. A couple of years ago, they had a superstar named Woody Austin who went 6-for-30 in this building, and they were out of the tournament.
Well, Woody had a great year, and he was Mr. Basketball. His brother Chad, younger brother Chad, now in the ball game that you just mentioned, so he's going to be a good one. He's getting a little taste of fire here.
And we're getting a little taste of Chad Kleine. He's a little short on that jumper, but we're getting a little taste of what he can do here. Underneath, will not fall. Richmond finally picks up the loose ball. Billy Wright. Inside, blocked by Kleine. Partially blocked. And then another jump held, possessed ball, and Richmond gets that one.
You notice that Brian Gilpin is out of the basketball game. Not Vernon going now. It was just Chad Kleine inside and basically four perimeter players.
How difficult is it, Gary, to stay away from getting into that up-tempo game? How difficult is that for Mount Vernon?
Well, that's kind of tough, particularly the way Richmond rebounds, because if they get the ball, they're going to run.
And they're going to shoot. Jared Howard short. Tries to get his own rebound. Steps on the line. Now you want to play what got you there. That's certainly the case in any basketball game. You want to play your style. And as you mentioned, though, Gary, Mount Vernon will have a hard time getting away from this kind of stuff today. Pull-up jumper goes to number 20, Chad Austin. His first two of the night, 11-8, three-point lead for the Red Devils.
Another turnover.
And the quick pass inside. They don't do anything but shoot the basketball.
Their best offense is their defense. They create those turnovers and score off the transition.
They did each central to get here in the final of the Richmond Regional. Huffman for three. Rebound underneath. And a foul for number 20, Chris White. The senior forward gets it to fall.
Well, that was a big basket for Mount Vernon because they're kind of getting caught up in that run and gun stuff, and they needed to get a bucket. And White made a real nice play, got the rebound, went up strong, and rolled it over the rim.
Multiple substitutions here is getting arrested. Number 12, Billy Wright, for the Red Devils. Back in the game, Lewis Alexander. And here's the situation right here. George Griffith comes at you all the time, never lets up. Nine deep. We'll see a lot of substitutions over the course of this basketball game for the Red Devils, Gary.
Well, they run up and down the floor, and he also runs them in and out off the bench. So, like you said, he has that depth, and he uses it.
The rematch of 1987 between these two basketball teams, Mount Vernon and Richmond. And it's a one-point game, 2:55 left. Steele, can he keep it in? Yes, nicely done by Brad Wright. Turns around and gets the bucket. Brad Wright has four.
In a word, athleticism.
Coach doesn't mind that too much if they're aggressive fouls, because that's what it's all about. Once in a while, you're going to slap the hand. Once in a while, you're going to get the ball picked up on you.
Well,
we see Coach talking to Shank on the sideline.
That's a foul of omission, not commission. No, coaches will go for those.
Absolutely. We'll go for a break right here. Three-point basketball game. It's a quick one. It's moving along. Richmond leads it 13-10. 2:44 remaining in the first quarter. High school basketball here on TTV4. Folks, I'm sure Alex Shank and Jimmy Howe were talking about how to control that Richmond pressure, huh? Hey, go this way. Hopefully that way will work.
Jimmy said, don't get in a hurry. Take care of that basketball.
And get it to Chad Kleine. His jumper short, tries to get the rebound, fight for the ball. And it belongs to Richmond.
Well, the Richmond bench came out. There's George Griffith. He helped the referee make that call. Richmond coaching staff, John Kate, Jeff Williams, they all came up to help that referee in case he had any indecision there. They wanted to tell him that's red ball.
And that's allowed by George Griffith, because he, like John Heaton, Jimmy Howell, and all the great coaches, but he especially, a credit to basketball here. He's why Hoosier Hysteria is what Hoosier Hysteria is. Legendary coaches like him. And a foul on Boyle. Jeff Boyle gets his first foul. Trouble with the quickness is what Coach Jimmy Howell said to me the other day when we talked about this Mount Vernon team. This is all there is in red is quickness.
Well, quickness is something you just can't substitute for. You can't practice against it. You can watch it on film, but it's a lot different when it's coming at you.
Well, you got that right. Coming inside, losing the ball with number 30, Robert Sanders, picked up by Mount Vernon. Huffman can't keep a hold of it. And finally, Richmond turns it over again as they were cheered on by their bench. Back up top for three. Billy Wright, yes. Billy Wright, the junior, gets a tray. And it's a six-point lead for Richmond.
What this pressure does, too, it just makes it very difficult to get into your set offense half court.
They're running at him. Huffman, he's got his work cut out today. Browning for three. Short rebound Richmond, and they won't take any time to push it back up. You love playing a style like that.
They're looking for the shot, but not burning zone. Doing a pretty good job right now.
From the other side, 22, Brad Wright, 6 points on the day.
See, another thing that you got to think about, that time they moved the ball pretty well, and that zone's going to get tired. You know, you can only move for so long, and then Richmond has the opening, and they knock it in.
So good discipline there. And Huffman shows good intensity right there, and he picks up the foul.
Huffman took it right to him there. He's a fiery little guy.
The foul's going to be on Lewis Alexander. That'll be his first. If we see the replay right here, Gary, Alexander had the arms up, but nonetheless, not the ball Huffman did.
Well, Huffman penetrated. He took it to those bigger fellows. You know, he's not shy, boy. He's a tough, gritty guy. He's a competitor. He'll try to start a fire, light a fire under his teammates. And he says, hey, if I can take it, these guys, surely you can take it.
71% free throw shooter. He's already 2 for 2 from the line on this afternoon. Now the game for Richmond, number 34, Trey O'Kelly. Coming out with Brad Wright. Jared Powers also back in the basketball game. He replaces Lewis Alexander.
It's a revolving door George Griffin has over on the bench. But that's good because you get a quick break and then you're ready to go right back in and play at 100%.
Austin. 2 for 3 from the line. 8-point lead, 54 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Hope you're enjoying the telecast. We'll be here all the rest of the afternoon along. And then the final tonight for a bump against the winner of this team. Roger Huffman has 3. And it's a 7-point game.
I don't think Richmond will hold it for 1. What do you think, Rob?
Exactly what I was thinking. They can score 3 or 4 in 44 seconds. You see the clock in the corner. Bottom right hand of your screen. 35 seconds left.
Mount Vernon staying with that zone. They're not going to play them man-to-man because they just can't come back there quickly.
This is the longest Richmond's held the ball all first quarter long. And they will maybe work for 1. I think sometimes coaches have a headphone and wait for what we're going to say, and then they do the opposite just to make us look like we're not quite sure. But we are sure that Richmond can light it up.
That's a good sign, though, because there are times when you have to be able to do this.
Great discipline, absolutely. And they're showing it here. Rod Frazier, jumper, short, rebound inside, finally picked up by Gilpin. They've got 2 seconds to throw it up. And just off the mark.
Shank gave it a try. That best shot was right on the mark.
Running and gunning, moving and grooving like Loyola Marymount. It's been a good one thus far. 18-11 is your score. At the end of one quarter, the Richmond Red Devils lead. We'll be back with more here on High School Basketball Day on TV4. The pressure defense of Richmond, they live and die by it. They lead by 7 right now in the basketball game.
Well, 18 points in the first quarter. You project that out, that's 72 points. If the score is in the 70s, Mount Vernon could be watching the contest tonight.
And Richmond averages actually 83 points a game. So look for even more lightning. And another jumper off the window falls for Chad Kleine, who's now got 6 points.
Mount Vernon continues to stay in that zone.
Maybe that's the only way they can keep up with him. But Gilpin shows what he does best. Defense is getting in the way. Brian Gilpin, 6'11", 210-pound junior, on his way to Indiana University.
Nice block.
Very nice athletic block. Bulked him up a little bit, put him down in Bloomington. Kleine will not get the road. Gilpin gets the follow, and it goes.
That's what Richmond cannot afford to let happen. They can't let those two guys get going inside.
The Twin Towers, if you will, when you look at a size. Especially Kleine. Sanders spins. Huffman helped make that call. I like watching Roger Huffman, the small point guard. He's just 5'8", but he's a senior. He's got that intensity that we saw in the last game.
He's kind of a Scott Skiles type. You know, he's just kind of a tough, nervy little guy. He does things the little guys maybe aren't supposed to do. He'll go right in there with the big fellas, and he won't back off 1 second.
There's the turnovers, pretty even considering Richmond's pressure. Mount Vernon 5, Richmond 4. So Mount Vernon's doing a good job of forcing some turnovers, and we have a travel call right there, so we'll go back the other way.
And now that goes up to 6 turnovers, 6-4. And Richmond's going to stay with that defense. So they're going to aggravate you. They're going to be pesky. They're going to grab. They're going to reach. They're going to jump at you. They're going to do all those things.
Now this isn't the time to be changing. This is the time to get out of the way of Brian Gilpin, who gets his second block on the day. Trying to grab the rebound. Kleine. He steps on the line and Richmond will keep the basketball. They lead by 3, 6:43 here remaining in the second quarter of basketball. The first half here in the Hinkle Regional. Brebeuf, if you're just joining us, is in the finals via a 56-46 victory this morning over Shelbyville.
That last transition, you saw Gilpin block 1 and alter 1, so he's the force inside.
Of course, outside of that jumper is Rob Zinkin, who gets on the board. His first field goal of the day. And the lead is back up to 5.
It was intended for Huffman. He actually intercepted his teammate's pass.
But didn't take the ill-advised shot. And Mount Vernon will set up for the jumper from Shank. Yes. Shank has 4.
You've got Mount Vernon now with some scoring inside, some scoring outside. That's the blend that they need.
Alex Shank gets 10 a game. Inside. Getting the roll. He's thinking. He gets 2 straight field goals.
He's got the Red Devils, a little lift off the bench.
And an errant pass and a turnover.
Turnover number seven.
Look who's smiling as that ball went flying by him, George Griffith. And look who's talking about control, patience, and discipline, Jimmy Howell.
Jimmy Howell told Huston, take the ball off the floor yourself. You know, don't force that pass if you don't have it. And Huston can take it up. That's the thing. He's better off taking it up and getting it into the half court and trying to make the long pass. Because when those passes hang, so do those Red Devils, and they'll snatch it right out of the air.
And working around the outside. Shot can come at any split second from these guys, can it? Inside, the shot comes and goes from the hands of the freshman, Jared Powers, who now has 5 points.
He's done a good job. He's hung right in there, taking what they've given him. Put himself really very well.
Kleine from 15.
Chad kind of rushed that. He was open. He should have set himself a little bit better.
We're going to have a foul called on Huston as he's jumping around. It's going to be a two-shot foul.
I think the idea that Huston thought maybe he got all ball there. Still shaking his head. He's looking at the other referee like, oh man, come on.
Jimmy Howell, I think, thinking about the same thing. Or at least hoping that be the case. 7-point lead, 5-12 remaining in the first half of basketball.
We've got Kevin Browning coming back in, and he's really been silent. He's a 12-point-per-game scorer, and usually a pretty good outside shooter, and I think he's only taken one or two shots. He really hasn't gotten the flow of the offense yet. And they can use his perimeter skills, and he needs to kind of pick up the pace and get involved a little bit offensively.
And when you talk about Kevin Browning, as we look at Billy Wright, a 74% free throw shooter missing the first, Kevin Browning described by the head coach Jimmy Howell as the best athlete on that basketball team, too. 12 points to an average per game, as you mentioned, Gary. As the second one falls for Billy Wright, and now he's got 4. Look at that pressure. A lot of red.
Nice.
Looks like there's about 8 red jerseys out there.
Nice look ahead by Chad Kleine. Guy looks inside, gives it to Gilpin. And there's a foul on the play, and I think that's going to be Zinkin.
And indeed it is. And if it is, that's his second. So send one of the other lightning bugs in, right? Or send a couple of them in, Coach.
That's right. I'm sure the time with Mount Vernon and Backburn must think, you've got to whistle a penalty here for too many men on the field. It seems like there must be 8 or 10 of those guys out there.
Let's take a look at the numbers from the first quarter, Gary.
I'm looking at Brian Gilpin right here. Gilpin, 53% field goal, 61% free throw shooter.
We'll let Brian go to the line, and we'll hit those statistics for you. Our next opportunity, folks, if he misses the first.
There's Jimmy Howell, a pensive Jimmy Howell. Hoping that Brian can drop the second one in, and he does.
Brian Gilpin has 3. We've got a 7-point basketball game. The Richmond Red Devils won't give you a second to look away. 3 on the way, Billy Wright. Yes. They're going to call it a 2. Everybody in the building, especially in red jerseys, was looking for 3. On the bench, they're going to call it a 2, so he has 6. Awful close there, Gear, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think maybe a little bit of converse.
And a lot of Chad Kleine inside who has 8. That pumps up the Mount Vernon crowd. Certainly does. Trying to pump up Richmond short on a jumper.
27-20, and the Raiders can come back, but they mishandle the ball. Another turnover out of bounds back to Richmond. And Jimmy Howell, once again, as he told Huston earlier, you take the ball up the court. That's the second time that Huston's tried to throw the long pass and lost it out of bounds.
Here's our statistics. We have a second, a little break here in the action.
Well, Mount Vernon 3-for-12, not getting a lot of good shots. That defensive pressure really bothering him there the first quarter. Free throws 3-for-3, 3-for-4, not much difference. Rebounds about even. A couple extra turnovers for the Marauders, but the defense probably Richmond's scoring the first quarter, causing that 33% shooting success.
They go other side for Wright for 3, and misses. Off the rebound and another miss, and a foul for a couple of red jerseys. Lewis Alexander and Robert Sanders neither get it to fall. And Chad Kleine's getting a lot of pressure on him. And he gives it to Huston wisely.
And that's what Huston's supposed to do. He brings the ball down and draws the foul. And that's what Jimmy Howell wants him to do. Bring it up. Bring it up. Because at his 5'8 size, he's low to the ground. He's got quickness. He's got strength. We've seen him maneuver his way into the front court. And when he does, he draws a foul from number 30 at Richmond. And that's Robert Sanders.
And that's his first.
But that's what Jimmy Howell wants Huffman to do. He's the point guard. He's the guy who can bring it up. If they're not open, no chance to get that ball. You can't set up your half-court offense until you get into the half-court.
That's the first, and that puts Mount Vernon in the bonus. So the line is Huffman shooting the 1-1. And he gets the first one to fall. Huffman, 4-5 from the line, 4 points on the day.
Shoots over 70% from the line, so he's got the percentages with him when he steps up there.
Four of six now from the line. All his shots have actually come from the line on this day. At least the ones that have fallen. Nice play inside Robert Sanders, their big man. He's got four.
He went straight up and over there. Nice shot in the paint by Sanders.
And the lead's back to eight. Quick to Gilpin, back outside to Browning. Back up top to regroup. Nice ball movement by Mount Vernon. Inside to Kleine, and it goes. Great ball movement.
Okay, Kleine's a good one, boy. He gets in that paint. He's a left-hander, and he's deadly from inside.
And he's in double figures with 10. And Sanders is looking for a something, but he gets blocked by Gilpin. Loose ball picked up and a foul.
He was looking for a shot in all the wrong places because Gilpin was there and put it right back. But that doesn't discourage Richmond. They'll come right back and put it up again. Final score from the South Bend Semi-State. Witco, 87. LaPorte, 73. So Coach Bill Patrick doing an excellent job recovering from the loss of four seniors from last year's regional champions, comes back with high-scoring Steve Nicodemus and derails the LaPorte Slicers of Joe Otis.
Roger Huffman was called for that foul on the Mount Vernon Marauders. That's his second. Let's keep an eye on that. Hopefully he won't get his third. Sanders misses the free throw. Rebound back up by Wright, but it won't fall.
Huffman brings that ball up the floor, facing that Richmond pressing, trapping defense.
Gilpin left side low, back up top Browning.
Browning's still been silent, and he's a big shooter, and a 12-point-per-game score, and he throws a nice pass to Shank for the basket.
Alex Shank has six.
Great recognition there by Kevin Browning. He looked inside, saw Shank cutting from the weak side, and threaded the needle right to him.
Moving underneath, and a foul. And I think Chad Kleine knows it.
Yeah, he doesn't look too happy about it. He's hitting himself on the head saying, man, I should have taken away that baseline. Here comes the pass. Here comes the drive. And the coaches tell you, never give that baseline. And Kleine did not beat the Richmond Red Devil to the spot and therefore drew the blocking foul.
His second personal foul. Chad Kleine has 10 points, two fouls. At the line, number 20, Chad Austin. As you mentioned, the younger brother of Woody Austin, as we say, Brad Wright coming to the game. A lot of folks hoping Woody will be back in the gold black next season, get those grades back up and come back and play for Gene Cady, whose team played extremely well down the line, but unfortunately got knocked off by the Temple Owls in the first round of the NCAA tournament.
Purdue needs some outside shooting. Woody can provide that, and hopefully he can get back in here and have a real strong senior year.
And he's a favorite, being an Indiana boy and former Mr. Indiana. As his younger brother does good. Hits both. He's got four. And we've got a good basketball game. A six-point lead for the Richmond Red Devils. 31-25. This is high school state championship semi-state style here on TTV4. Our score here at the Hinkle Fieldhouse. Richmond 31, Mount Vernon 25. In Evansville, Washington Catholic, the only undefeated team in the state coming in, losing by 13 in the fourth quarter to Vincennes. We'll keep an eye on that one. Washington Cath may be done for the year very soon.
58-45, 13-point lead for the Owls. This might be a little tough for Washington Catholic to overcome.
Here's Shank trying to hit the three. That's off the mark. Browning with the rebound. Gives the pass inside to Gilpin. He's snatched away by Robert Sanders.
Quick hands by the Red Devils.
The Devils were naughty there, taking the ball away. Sanders will wait, make a decision. Sooner or later, he'll get it back, but he's called for the travel. And he doesn't quite believe it.
Well, George Griffith didn't think so either, and Sanders didn't think so, but two out of three doesn't rule this time. The referee has the deciding vote. He said he traveled, so he did. There's that long pass that Jimmy Howell's not thrilled about, but Huffman gets away with it this time.
It works. It's okay, and this one's okay, but it won't fall for Gilpin. Nice pass inside. Trying to answer with the jumper off the mark. With Brad Wright, rebound Brian Gilpin. Both teams gotten a little bit cold here in this
early minutes after that timeout. Still a six-point lead with 1:46 remaining in the first half. Mount Vernon and Richmond. Gilpin, window, yes. Gilpin has five.
As long as Gilpin keeps that ball above his head, nobody's going to get it. He took brought it down a couple times and lost it on rebound.
Nice jumper inside. You figure he puts that ball above his head, and he's about 7'6", isn't he, with those long arms?
Unless Rick Smith is in town, nobody else is going to take it from him.
Robert Sanders got that basket for Richmond. Inside, Schenck won't get it. Tip in, won't go. Rebound, Richmond. Coming away with the ball is Chad Austin. Chad pulls up from 15, yes.
Chad went coast to coast, got the rebound, brought it down, went to the paint, skied, flied, and scored.
And he's got six. And we're below a minute left. And right in front of our table, we got good action. And these Richmond guys are fired up. A good team as they are. Here's the replay.
You see Brad Wright go there and hit the guy. Gonna hit Huffman, rolls out of bounds, and what you can't, you can see Huffman getting up, but what you couldn't see when the referee blew the whistle, Brad Wright, as we see him go there, took out his mouthpiece and smiled at the referee and nodded, yep, I fouled him.
Brad Wright with his second personal. One of those omission commissions again, though, huh, Gary?
That's right. As long as it's commission, the coaches don't care too much because you're out trying to do something. You're trying to make something happen. It's when you're standing around, when you're not doing, when you keep your feet planted in reach, that's when the coaches don't like it very well.
And that would be omission. Right?
That's right.
And from the line, Huffman hits the first. So any of you people who are out there, like I was the first time Gary used that phrase, wondering what omission and commission was, getting out Webster's, don't worry about it. There's your explanation. Huffman has 5 points off from the line. He has six off from the line.
If you're omitting movement, if you're omitting aggressiveness, coaches aren't very happy. If you're committing some aggressiveness, trying to make things happen, they usually won't get after you, except that time Billy Wright committed a pretty good pass, but his teammate, number 34, Trail Kelly, was not paying attention. And that caused George Griffith to slam the hardwood floor here and tell him to wake up.
Omission, right?
That's right. He omitted the look.
Gilpin, the Gilpin.
He did not omit the drive. He drove very strong to the basket. He has to do that more.
Brian Gilpin goes inside.
There it is. Here comes Big Brian. And the big thing he did right there, he did not put the ball on the floor. Too often guys take that extra dribble. He did not. He went right up with the basketball. And as we said, when he goes up, he goes way up, and there's nobody else up there.
And he's also fouled on the play. And this team can pull into it within 3 points in the Mount Vernon Marauders. Gilpin at the line, hits it. The foul is on Alexander.
Well, they've got 18 points out of the Twin Towers now, and that's good news for Jimmy Howe and the Marauder fans.
And Richmond had pushed it up a bit, but now they're right back in it. By the Mount Vernon Marauders, within 3:26 seconds left, you see the shot clock in the corner. The game clock as it counts down to halftime. 20 seconds. Chad Austin for Frazier. Frazier gets away from the pressure. Almost a turnover, but kept alive by Richmond nicely by Rod Frazier. Now low side, 42. Rob Dick is short. Rebound Mount Vernon, and that's the half shot here. And Huffman's jacked up about it. Gary, I'll tell you, big move by the Mount Vernon Marauders to get back in the last couple of minutes of that quarter there to pull them within three. That bodes well going into the locker room, doesn't it?
Well, they outscored them in the second quarter. Mount Vernon came back. They hung tough. They were able to get the ball inside a little bit more to Kleine and Gilpin. They have 18 points between them now, and they're going to have to do that because the perimeter game has been almost non-existent for Mount Vernon. Outside of Alex Schenck, the other fellas, Huffman and Browning, have not been able to get the outside shooting in gear. So if you can't score outside, you got to go inside. And that's what Mount Vernon was able to do in that second quarter in the persons of Kleine and Gilpin.
It's been an exciting first half. The Richmond Red Devils going to the locker room, leading by three over the Mount Vernon Marauders, 35-32. We'll be back to talk about the first half after this short timeout. This is high school basketball on TTV4. Welcome back here to the Hinkle Fieldhouse. We're at halftime of our second game. The winner of this one will meet the Brebeuf Braves, a winner earlier today, 56-46 over Shelbyville. Richmond by three over Mount Vernon.
35-32 along court side with Gary Donna. I'm Mike Goldberg. And Gary, this has been a contrasting style, but it's been a close basketball game. Both teams' styles have worked well in periods of time for each team.
Well, Richmond, I think, really was the aggressor, as they're going to be most of the game, but particularly so in the first quarter. Seemed to bother Mount Vernon a little bit. They had trouble getting the ball up the floor. They had trouble getting their offense set. They had trouble getting the ball inside to Kleine and Gilpin. But in the second quarter, I think they adjusted much better. And Huffman did a good job of getting the ball up court. They looked inside. They got Kleine. They got Gilpin. They did their job. And consequently, they outscored the Red Devils by, I think, five in the second quarter. And now they're back in the ball game. It's 35-32. And Mount Vernon is hanging in there.
You know, important to note about Mount Vernon, when you saw them come back into this basketball game also, you saw them doing it inside with their big guys, Chad Kleine, Brian Gilpin. You saw them doing it the way they got here.
And that's right. And the key thing is, you got to get the ball up the court to get it inside. And they weren't able to do that very well in the first quarter. But they've done a much better job in the second quarter. Alex Shank has been a real big help because he's got three buckets, which relieves a little of that inside pressure. But we still got to see Kevin Browning assert himself a little bit. And we got to see Huffman continue to do a good job getting that ball up the floor so they can make the entry passes into Kleine and Gilpin.
Well, Chad Klein's going to move his way along to Peoria, Illinois. He'll be in Bradford University. He'll be one of those Bradford players. And he's played well today. He's shown it along as well as it can be. And I'll tell you what, he's very, very, very tough.
Here comes the man we're talking about, Chad Kleine. He goes up very strong with that left hand and slam jams. That was a big emotional play for the Marauders. And as you mentioned, he's going to be an excellent player at Bradley. He was an early signee. And I tell you what, there'll be some Indiana schools might wish that he stayed in Indiana. Now here's Alex Shank, and the ball is batted away by Brad Wright, I believe. And Brad goes down, chases it down. Good hustle, good athletic move. Wheels, comes all the way back around full circle and banks it off the glass. So he did everything right. Aggressive defensively, tracked down the ball, got it, made a good smart move to the hoop. You can't ask for any more than that.
You know, we remember the Bradley Braves, and we remember, of course, Percy Hawkins now in the NBA. He was a dandy one. Chad Kleine trying to do the same thing. Does he have the NBA touch? Well, he certainly has a great college touch right now.
Well, he's going to be a good college basketball player. He's an excellent student. He's a smart player. He made a couple miscues in the first quarter, but he came back and had a very strong second quarter, and he'll battle inside. He's not a great jumper, but he gets good position, and he has a good touch around the basket.
Well, we have a good basketball game here at the Hinkle Fieldhouse. We're at halftime here. When we come back, we'll talk about what to expect in the second half. Right now, though, it's a three-point Richmond lead over Mount Vernon. This is high school basketball on TTV4. We're back here in between the second game of the Hinkle semi-state. Game two, the Richmond Red Devils, Mount Vernon Marauders, three-point Richmond lead as we are in the intermission, as they call it here, about 4:24. And take a look at how the first quarter numbers came along, Gary.
Well, 7 for 18 for the Red Devils. They didn't shoot very well, but, you know, they got a lot of shots. That's the key right there. They got a lot of shots. They only shot 39%, but it didn't hurt them because the Marauders only shot 33% in the first quarter. So, you know, nothing hurt there for the Red Devils.
And then as we look at the second quarter and really the first half statistics, things look a little bit the same. It's a close basketball game.
Well, oftentimes the second quarter becomes better because both teams get a little more adjusted. They get loose. A lot of times the first quarter, they're kind of feeling each other out and they're trying to get established. So the shooting percentages both got up into 40% range during the second quarter, and that's a little better. And you see from the free throw line, both teams doing a pretty good job, 75% for the Red Devils on 6 of 8. Mount Vernon 8 for 11, getting a lot of free throws, and that comes about as a result of Richmond's aggressive defense. Rebounds about even, 16 to 15. Marauders just one edge, and the turnovers there, as you saw, not a real big difference either. So this is a pretty even ball game statistically. Sometimes statistics will lie, but these don't. They indicate a close ball game. We look up at the scoreboard, it's 35-32. It is a close ball game.
And the turnovers, 9 is an interesting point to bring up. The Marauders have only turned over the basketball 9 times, and when you look at a team that forces 24 turnovers, it might seem like a lot, but it's really not. It's 3 minus the average through halftime, and we've got a 3-point game at halftime. Richmond a leader. We'll be back to start the second half after this short timeout. High school basketball here on TTV4. At the half, the Richmond Red Devils by 3, 35-32 over Mount Vernon. And when you talk about the Red Devils, you talk about a balanced team and scoring the indication. Billy Wright, Brad Wright, Chad Austin, all with 6, a trio of 6s, Gary.
Well, you couldn't get much more balanced than that. You got 5 players there, and they're all evenly balanced, no foul trouble. So Richmond's in pretty good shape.
35 points at halftime. I think Richmond would probably like to have 45, because then you're getting into an area that Mount Vernon doesn't want to get into. So Richmond has a slight advantage, but Mount Vernon hanging in there.
And speaking of Mount Vernon, you check out the scoring there and there, and that's really apropos too. Their big man is Chad Kleine. He's got 12, and then Alex Schenk is coming with 6 good points. Upton has 6, Brian Gilpin has 6, and White with 2.
The big story there is who is not on that list, and that's Kevin Browning, because usually he provides them 12 points per game. He's yet to score. Let's see what he can do in the second half.
Now let's see about our second half, as we're ready to start with basketball here. 8 minutes is on the clock for the third quarter of a 3-point game. The Richmond Red Devils, the Mount Vernon Marauders, playing for the chance to meet Allen Henderson with a sore thigh tonight. Quick jumper for Richmond. They waited 7 seconds to score right there.
That's the same thing they did to start the ball game.
Pass, Browning gives, and a quick turnover.
Well, see, now right there, Kevin Browning, you know, he's thinking a little bit. He should have gone to the basket. He had the shot. He's not having a real good day offensively, and he really kind of overpassed there. He had about a 5-foot shot. Gilpin had a 3-foot. There's not that much difference. Kevin should have gone ahead and taken the shot.
Traveling violation called on Billy Wright. Rod Frazier got that jumper 8 seconds into the quarter for his 4th point of the day.
And Kevin Browning, if he would have dropped that shot in, that really would have loosened him up, so he needs to pop one to get going offensively.
Kevin Browning, a 6'1 junior forward, called the best athlete on the team. Quick pass down low, Richmond again, and gets the ball.
And look at Jimmy Howe. He looked at Huffman and said one word, why? Why? He's told him twice in the first half, don't make that long pass unless you're sure of it, and that's another turnover. Look at Jimmy. He's got over there, it's a head, and his head resting on his hands, looking down. He's really kind of taking care of his shoe right now. He doesn't even want to look at him to go for it momentarily.
A lot of red to look at today. A sea of red, if you will. Brad Wright gives the jumper. And it goes for Robert Sanders. Sanders, his 4th field goal. He has 8. Kleine on the inbound. Jack Kleine, not the man you want bringing the ball up, but fortunately he drew the foul there.
Well, he got away with it because he got fouled, but he was about one dribble away from oblivion as far as possession was concerned.
And here you see it right here. Stripping it away was Billy Wright, but getting called for the foul before he was able to do so. For Billy Wright, though, that's just his first foul on the day. He averages 4 steals.
The one good thing Clyde did, though, was he kept his body between the basketball and the defensive man, allowed him to draw the foul.
39-32, 6:58. Inside Gilpin, window, yes.
I'll tell you what, when he gets posted down low and he gets the ball up high, he's dangerous.
He's showing good control of that 6'11 body. Jumper away from about 18. Will not fall for Brad Wright. Gilpin the rebound.
Now you see Gilpin there, though he brought that ball down around his waist. He should keep it above his head.
A la Ted Kitchell.
Huffman.
Traveling violation.
And number 30, Robert Sanders, didn't think he traveled there. He had a little show of expression. And wisely, his teammates said, hey, man, calm down. They didn't want a technical. They didn't want to lose possession. They didn't want to lose points.
And with the technical, not only comes the technical foul shots, which can gain you some things. We take a look at the turnovers, 11-8 now. It also changes momentum very often. Mount Vernon would like to change the momentum of Browning.
All right, there's Kevin Browning. That's what he needed. He needed to drop one in. He flashed into the paint, got the good pass, went up, didn't hesitate, real relaxed, shot the ball, followed through, and now he's on the scoreboard.
Big bucket, as Gary mentioned, for Kevin Browning. His first of the day. Answering is Richmond, no. Schenk finally pulls down the rebound.
So we got ourselves an excellent basketball game here, Mike.
It's a 3-pointer at halftime. A couple minutes into the third quarter, it's a 3-pointer again. Huffman doing what he needs to do. Dribble the ball up.
He thought about that pass.
He's heard about it, too. Kleine inside, goes. Nice pass. Alex Schenk. Vernon has pulled to within one.
And look, Kleine clears him out. Chad Kleine clears him out underneath. If they score here, Richmond might be able to use a timeout. Momentum is now going against them.
Huffman doing what he needs to do now. Roger Huffman, the 5'8 senior point guard. Off the mark is Kleine. And the lead is safe, at least for now. Richmond trying to push it back up. Ball, nice follow inside, double pump, goes and falls for Brad Wright. Brad Wright's got eight.
At 5'10", he did a heck of a job getting the ball off the board with 6'11", Brian Gilpin working.
He certainly did do that. I think Jimmy Howe got the message across to Roger Huffman.
Jimmy Howe's going to get a message to Brian Gilpin here, though. He's not very happy with Brian. See him walking away from the bench there. Jimmy Howe had a few choice words.
Robert Sanders gets called for the personal foul. Quickly, two fouls on Richmond.
So you have two excellent coaches here, George Griffith and Jimmy Howe. If you travel around the state, there's a lot of outstanding coaches. These two rank right at the top. They've been very successful with their program. They have respect to their ball clubs. And you can see it out on the floor, both teams going toe-to-toe.
These young men, so disciplined. And some of them, as we know, won't go on to play basketball for a living. Although this kid might, Chad Kleine. But it is also a great assist again from Huffman.
That was Kevin Browning, I believe. Kevin Browning in the middle. And that was a great pass. And when you make great passes, you look very good.
Gilpin with a good defensive move, but just a little bit too much body. He's called for his second foul. That was a great pass.
Browning in the middle. He looks through, and boy, I've seen that. Browning hit that shot a while ago, so now he's looser. Now he's looking. Now he's comfortable. And that one shot made a big difference. That was the best play of the ball game, I think, as far as recognition and threading the needle.
And it all started out with number 13, the point guard, Roger Huffman, who got the ball past the midcourt so they could set it up.
That's right.
So if it was hockey, we could give two assists.
That's right.
Huffman, Browning, and then inside to the big man. Alexander, the big man, on the line, and he hits it. Lewis Alexander's on the scoreboard.
Gilpin and Klein each have two fouls right now, which is no problem, but if either picks up a quick third, it could develop into a problem.
Speaking of two fouls, Brad Wright, Robert Sanders, Rob Zinkin, and Lewis Alexander have two for the Red Devils. Alexander has 2 points on the deck. Three-point basketball game. Gilpin. And he tries.
Browning made another nice pass. He found Gilpin in there, and Gilpin, there's a case probably where he was a little too far. He probably should have put the ball on the floor a little quicker and used another dribble to go to the hoop.
Jumper from Brad Wright. Short rebound, Brad Wright. He does everything right,
except he charged.
That was the right play by Chad Kleine.
Chad Kleine stood his ground pretty good, and Brad Wright was on the fly, left his feet. Here comes a shot. There's the battle inside. Here comes Wright. There's Kleine holding his zone and drawing the foul, and I think that's three on Brad Wright.
Yeah, that really was a close one, too. Could have gone either way. Brad Wright, though, three personal fouls. Watch number 22. Big Chad Kleine says, that ball's mine.
Looking around for some help, so there's Browning
looking for the little guys. I get paid to score, guys. Get it into me. Shank, one of those guys who can get it in. Browning touches in there. That time, Gilpin with the follow off the window. Gilpin has 12. Great follow and rebound by Brian Gilpin on his way to Indiana University.
14 for Klein, 12 for Gilpin, 26 from their inside post guard.
The Twin Towers of the Mt Vernon Marauders, if you will. Right. Gilpin. Kleine picks up the loose foul. And George Griffith wanted the foul.
Well, they got a foul, but it was on Rob Zinkin.
And really, Zinkin wasn't thinking that time because Kleine already had possession. He was about 80 feet from the basket. And there was really no reason to foul him. Here's the battle. Kleine
nice
got
ball.
It.
Barely there. There's Kleine right there. And now Zinkin comes to reach in.
Jimmy Howell and George Griffith both up, as you can see, folks. They're both up and into this game, and they ought to be. One-point game, just over 3 minutes remain in the third quarter. The semi-state semifinal. Chad Kleine in the paint. Punches it back out. Shank for three. Short. Rebound Sanders. Off the backboard, actually. On the back, got a weird bounce. So Richmond gets the ball anyway. And Jimmy Howell again says why. And why did Jimmy Howell say why there?
Well, he didn't think that they needed that three-point shot. They could have got the lead. He wanted to get a better shot. Emotionally, if you can get that lead, you really get that adrenaline flow.
They got another chance to get the lead. The adrenaline is starting to move Mount Vernon's way. They haven't been able to punch away in the scoreboard yet, but they've really played their kind of basketball in this quarter.
working the ball around nicely. Huffman gives to the big man, Kleine, and he lays it in. Nice play by Roger Huffman giving it to Chad Kleine. Listen to that crowd now. Just a one-point lead makes such a difference when you're trying to catch up. Will the lead last for long? No, it will not. Jared Howard, 6'5" freshman pivot man, doing a good job, and there's a block. And George Griffith is trying to convince the referee, but it really wasn't a block. That block done number 30, Robert Sanders, and that's his third personal. So quickly, Richmond has gotten three guys into three foul territory here, as you see the replay. The action's an attempt. They're falling all over the place. Don't go away and fall away from your TV, though. One-point basketball game. Richmond leads it 45-44, 2:20 left. This is high school basketball here on TCB4. A shooting foul was called. That was the fifth foul. We went into the bonus, so Chad Kleine, while we were away, drained two from the line, and the lead has changed hands. 46-45. Coaches are talking, Gary. What are they talking about?
Well, George Griffith wants to get the momentum swinging back towards the Red Devils, but I'm sure he's telling his people they've got to reestablish the defensive intensity. They've got to disrupt Mount Vernon. They can't let the ball up the floor so easily. They're going to have to pressure Roger Huston on the other side. Jimmy Howe is telling his kids, keep up the good work. He's telling Huston, get the ball up court. Because if they can feed him up court and get into their half court, they don't need a fast break. They don't need a lay-in. They just need to get in the half court and then get the ball to Kleine, get the ball to Gilpin, and they'll have some success. Because then if Richmond has to come away from those big kids, if they have to fall back, then you got Browning, you got Shank, you got Huffman to do some long range damage.
The Devils want to get that pointer going out. Poke a few Vernon Marauders. Poke a few buckets. Get a lead again. As Mount Vernon has picked up the lead, we've had the lead change hands a couple of times here in the third quarter of this basketball game. Richmond led for the majority of the first half.
Kleine has 16 and Gilpin 12, so 28 points from the inside people. Mount Vernon's still in that zone. They've been in it practically the whole ball game.
Waiting and popping is Rod Frazier. He's got six. Mount Vernon pushes it up rather quickly. Weird to see not a lot of red jerseys for Kevin Browning. He says, I know these guys are around somewhere. And there's Kevin. He thought about it.
He had the shot. You're going to have to hit that sooner or later.
He'll go ahead and take it and bury it. That is exactly right. Give it to me, I'll do it. And it's a tray. And it's a two-point lead for Mount Vernon.
They dared him to take it, and he finally stepped up and nailed it. That's a big shot.
5 points for Kevin Brown. Richmond, same thing. They're going to let him take it. Number 34, Trey O'Kelly. Finally, low side. Eight-footer goes for number 42, Rob Zinkin. He's got six. Pass inside of Kleine. Kleine quickly gets it up to Brown.
And there's where the ball belongs. It all starts with Roger Huston, the point guard, the senior point guard, and a good one.
And then it goes inside of Kleine, maybe outside of Browning. Maybe a three from Huffman. No, short, and the rebound by Jared Powers. Quickly pushed up by Richmond. No surprise there, 34, Trey O'Kelly. Rebound, 42, yes. Rob Zinkin with the rebound in the basket.
Well, the 6'4 junior's got 8 points off the bench. He's a real factor for the Red Devils now.
Two-point basketball game, 34 seconds remaining in the quarter. Kevin Browning. Inside to Gilpin and a jam. 51-51.
Nice pass by Browning through the defensive man and got it where it belongs, right into the 6'11 Brian Gilpin, and he got it where it belongs, right in the hoop.
16 seconds. 13. Richmond will work to go into the intermission with a lead, they hope. Frazier, short. Kleine rebound, 2 seconds. That's going to be it. Couldn't ask for better, could we, Gary Donovan?
Nope, 51-51, and we got ourselves a barn burner heading into the fourth quarter.
We expected it to be close. It doesn't get any closer than a tie basketball game. 8 big minutes remain on the clock. Who knows, maybe even more. Richmond and Mount Vernon tied after three. High school basketball, the Hinkle semi-state finals. Semi-finals here on TCB4.
51-51. Richmond, Mount Vernon, end of three. End of the basketball game. Vincennes is in the finals in Evansville. They beat Washington Catholic 76-66.
Washington Catholic is done with their Cinderella undefeated season. There will not be an undefeated state champion this year. But a great season for you. First year coach Mike Adams and his Washington Catholic ball club. Only about 115 or 120 students in the whole school, so they had a great year.
And this is a great basketball game we have right here. Mount Vernon. Inside to the tower. Gilpin. Will he get the roll? No. And a foul underneath that. And I believe it's going to be on Gilpin. He tried to run away and hide almost. He ran to the bench to talk to Jimmy Howell, actually. But nonetheless, he gets called for the foul, and that's his third.
When you're 6'11", you really can't hide.
And Coach doesn't want him to too often. Brian Gilpin has certainly given UIU fans a couple of things to think about. I know on that big day when we heard about Allen Henderson and Todd Lindemann, you know, and the guy from Brian Evans, I believe it is, from Terre Haute South, we thought, who's this junior committing to IU already? Well, this is the guy right here, Gilpin. And this is the guy, Sanders, and he gets it. Robert Sanders with 10. He averages 19. If he has 9 left, it's going to be tough for Mount Vernon. And Richmond leads by a deuce. And there's a turnover.
Jimmy Howe just told Chad Kleine, get the ball to Roger. He doesn't want Chad bring it up. He wants Huffman bringing it up.
They avoided the pressure very well in the third quarter. That's why they're in this basketball game. Fourth quarter started out, at least in the early goings, Richmond-type basketball. But that one won't foul, but we've got a foul. A reach over. Exactly what Richmond wants right here. The Twin Towers are getting called for fouls. And it's on Kleine, and that's his third. And now quickly, Kleine and Gilpin pick up a foul each.
That's right. We talked about it earlier. They each had two, and now they've got three, and there's a lot of time left to go. Now the big question is, can they play with three? Shelbyville kids did in the first game pretty well.
So does this guy pretty well, too. But that's going to be a two from Sanders. Robert Sanders quickly 4 points here in the fourth quarter. And he's got 12. Kevin Browning.
I think Kevin there really could have got the ball up and over to Gilpin. Gilpin was down low and could have slammed jam, but Kevin committed, and of course once he did commit and go to the basket, he had to follow through with it.
Louis Alexander said, get away from me. 6'1 compared to 6'5, Alexander showing his athleticism, but picked up the foul, and that's his third.
Well, Mount Vernon got back in the third quarter with Roger Huffman's ball handling, getting the ball up the court, Kevin Browning coming alive, getting 5 points offensively, and the big men combining for 32 points at this point, Kleine and Gilpin.
Kevin Browning going to the line and bearing his first free throw of the afternoon. He's a 70% free throw shooter, 52% from the field.
And now he's halfway to his 12-point per game scoring record.
As he has six. Seven.
We said at halftime that Browning would have to step up, and he has.
Richmond always trying to step up the tempo.
Mount Vernon's here. Mount Vernon, you'll notice, still in that zone.
Richmond has one speed, and that's awful fast. Jumper miss. Wright does such a nice job of following up his missed shots, but he can't get the second one to go. Richmond still with the ball, but they travel.
But when Wright tried that follow-up shot, Gilpin really altered it. He made that shot be almost bring rain here. It went up so high in the atmosphere. So Gilpin didn't get a block, but he certainly altered the shot, and then that caused the travel on the ensuing.
Four more turnovers, five now for Mount Vernon. 14-9-1. Will they turn it into points? Yes. They turn it into a three from number 24, Rod Frazier. Big turnaround right there. Five-point lead for Richmond. Mark down your time at home, folks. That was big.
And it came off a turnover.
The 14th of the night. Forced by these guys. A foul right there. That'll be on number 12, Billy Wright. That'll be his second.
But what you saw in that last transition is what Richmond does best. They caused the turnover, got the ball back, and scored off the transition subsequent to the turnover. So when we say their best offense is their defense, that's exactly what we mean. They caused the turnover, got the shot, and this time it happened to be a three, and emotionally there's no bigger shot than a three-point basket.
Getting a little break, a well-deserved break, is Brad Wright, as Jared Powers, the freshman, comes back in. Louis Alexander will also sit down. Coach isn't afraid to go to his very deep bench in this situation. But he's still got those couple of guys that really make his heart beat. And those are the guys he's given this minute or two break right now. They'll come back in. Roger Huffman, 6 of 8 from the line, as you see, 7 of 9 now. All his points today, all 7, have come from the charity stripe.
Well, he handles the ball a lot, and he's in the middle of action, as it should be, as the point guard. And he's a tough guy to contend with. He's low to the ground, and he's quick, and he draws a foul.
Huffman gets the roll. 8 of 10. It'll be interesting as we count it down. Our camera people, our tech people do such a great job of showing you the story here, putting in a lot of shots of the coaches. We'll see what's on the expressions of their faces. Right now, one coach, George Griffith, is happy. One, Jimmy Howell, says, I don't want to see any more of those jumpers going. And that was hit by Sanders. And quickly, a foul called on the red team. Huffman able to do a nice job on Chad Austin.
Huffman's living a little bit there. He paid the price for drawing that foul. Here's the inbounds pass. And there's the collision. And Huffman lands hard. I think he got a body foul there on Chad Austin. And here's Jimmy Howe talking to Chad Kleine, giving him a few words of advice, encouragement, motivation. This guy doesn't need any motivation. Call this guy the roadrunner. He's up and down the court. He's all over the place.
Shooting 80% today. He shoots 71% on the season. As Brad Wright comes back in the basketball game, is sitting down his cousin Billy, the younger of the two. He's the junior. Brad Wright's the senior. They both average 12 points a game. Huffman makes it look easy.
Two things we've heard a lot today. Henderson on the rebound and Huffman at the line.
Mount Vernon is hoping they'll be able to stay that tonight. Not too much of Henderson on the rebound.
But how forced to line at the line.
Double figures all from the charity stripe. We're running out of places to mark it down as the timeout is called. We'll take a break in a three-point basketball game. The Richmond Red Devils and Mount Vernon Marauders. Semi-state, semifinal action here on TTV4. We're back of a three-point basketball game, 5:34. Nobody's going to change anything right now. They're going to go with what got them here. It is an old cliche, but it is apropos in this basketball game. Richmond won't slow down and try to work the clock. They'll try to put a lot of points. The old adage, the best offense is sometimes on the offense. The best defense is offense. Right, Gary?
That's right. There's Powers. Can't get it to go.
That offense won't go, but the rebound could not be handled by Gilpin, and they'll keep the basketball. The best defense is offense.
And sometimes your best offense is defense.
Sometimes your best offense is Brad Wright. Not that time, though. Short, Kleine with the rebound. And he's stripped by the Red Devils. And they get it in, followed by Rod Frazier.
And there's a perfect example of what I said earlier. Why did he have the ball down around his waist? Kleine at 6'8 should have had the ball above his head.
Gilpin. Goes in and does it almost right, but not enough.
And that should be 4 on Brad Wright. An excellent defensive position and taken the charge by Roger Huffman. Textbook case here. You tell a guy, stand, hold your ground. Here's the pass, the errant pass. Here comes Wright. Out of your screen, out of your left, you see Huffman gets there. He beat his man to the spot. He got there, he got set, and he didn't move. He drew the foul. Good call by the referee, good camera work there. That's an excellent call, and that's the toughest call in basketball, charging or blocking. But Huffman left no doubt. He was set. He drew the charge.
And thanks to Roger Huffman, Brad Wright has to take a rest with 4 fouls. 5-point lead, Richmond Red Devils. Another turnover. Richmond will go with Sanders, and he stops the clock and drops. 16 points for Robert Sanders. Foul away. Foul will be on Sanders, and that's his 4th. So coach is going to start to have to worry a little bit. George Griffith thinking about Brad Wright and Robert Sanders with 4 fouls each. It's still a lot of time left. 4 minutes, 17 seconds in this basketball game. A 7-point Richmond lead. It was tied after 3 quarters at 51 apiece. You know, there's two schools of thought as we watch Huffman trying to make his 11th point from the line here, Gary. You either dribble through the press or you stop and you make the short passes to work for the press. Why the dribbling through the press for Mount Vernon?
Well, I think in this case, because you got a guy who can do that. He, like I said, he's low to the ground. He's quick. He takes care of the ball well, and he can get the ball up to the floor. And he's been successful in doing that, whereas if you stop and throw the long pass, that pass is up there for a while. And those Richmond kids are quick, and they can get to that pass. And if you try to throw over him, you throw it out of bounds, which happened a couple of times.
They do shoot free throws, too.
So if you got a guy like Huffman that can get it up the floor, until they trap him and take it away, which they've done very seldom, let him bring it up.
64-59, he's brought it up, and he's put it down from the line. 12 of 14. Frazier jumper goes. Rod Frazier.
Richmond has now taken 67 field goal attempts to only 40 for Mount Vernon.
Rod Frazier now with 9 points. Nice job. 66-59. Mount Vernon trying to come back. Browning. Yes. Kevin Browning with 11. Drawing the charge? No.
I don't think he got set that time.
Close, though.
Here comes the call. See, he's still moving. He never got set. He took the charge, but here you go. Now you see him coming over, and he never really got set. He never got both feet set. He never beat him to the spot. Good call by the referee. Good camera work as well.
Huffman with his third personal foul. But still not in the bonus is Richmond, so they'll inbound. They will be on the next foul. Already in the bonus is Mount Vernon. This guy has to outhand Rod Frazier. 13 points.
Now you got a guy dribbling the ball, shouldn't be dribbling the ball, but he drew a foul, he got away with it.
Every time we bring it up, he gets away with it. But more often than not, it feeds right into the hands of Richmond. They can trap those guys, the big guys who don't control the ball quite as well as the little Huffmans on that team. That works to their advantage. And as the percentages roll on, obviously more often than not, we see turnovers come about because of that, Gary.
Well, if he's going to hold the ball, then he needs to get it above his head, which he did an okay job. He didn't get it all the way up, but he did draw the foul. And he's going to go to the line. And Fines had a nice ball game, 18 points. He can make it 20 if he can drop in his free throws.
77% free throw shooter. He's 2 for 2 tonight from the line. 3 for 3.
Fines an excellent player. He's been selected to play in the East-West Indiana All-Star Classic. It'll be at Indiana State at the Home Center on April 6th. And he, along with a lot of other talented players, but he'll make his presence felt because he's one of the state's very best.
We've got a timeout called on the floor as Chad Kleine will wait to come back and shoot his second, try to get another basket in there. And as we wind it down, we look at 3:17 left, 68-62. Let's be our mind in the huddle again, Gary, if you will, as we think about the huddles. First of all, the Richmond Red Devils, what are they talking about?
Well, I think they want to keep playing. You know, they don't want to stop playing offensively, but they want to take some pretty good shots if they can. Now, he's showing them something down here. Difficult to tell what he's doing. Looks like he's talking about more about defense than he is offense here. I think they want to...
Yeah, we may be able to hear him. I'm trying to listen to George Griffin.
Griffith was talking about defense and number 13. They want to try to pressure 13, which is Huffman. And I'm sure Jimmy Howell wants Mount Vernon to take care of the basketball and punch it inside. If it's not there, then Browning and Huffman and Shank have to step up and then shoot the perimeter shots.
Folks, right now, you want atmosphere? Just take a listen. This is what it's all about. Everybody in that timeout was on their feet. And you think it was loud at your homestead, you should hear it here at the Hinkle Fieldhouse. Loud in the huddle. Coach is trying to get their guys fired up.
And Chad Kleine's had a loud day offensively, with now he just, that free throw gets to the 20-point mark. He averages 19, so he just went over his average.
Quickly pushing it up Richmond. But losing the ball, regaining confidence though. Frazier with it now. Billy Wright.
Mount Vernon's out of their zone. Now they're man-to-man. First time in the ballgame I've noticed that. Nice ball
work. Brian Gilpin-wise. And a rebound on the break.
is White. But he can't get it to fall. Rebound, Browning, yes!
Well, there's the athletic ability I talked about Kevin Browning earlier. Nice body control, got up high in the air and went for the follow-up.
And a travel and a turnover.
Chris White short on that layup there, got the ball at the bottom of the rim, but Browning alertly following, really went after the basketball. Excellent follow-up. Now Mount Vernon's got it back, and it's 68-65, and they can draw ever closer.
Turnover on the play. Turnovers have been the story today. It's back to a three-point game. Kleine,
so within one, yes. 22 points for Chad Kleine. We're back to within one, folks. Don't go anywhere.
And we're going to the wire.
Answering, though, is Frazier.
With the 2 points.
Huffman. Straight pass to Browning. Browning with 13 second half points. Oh, they wanted Sanders to take it. Instead, he goes inside, and there'll be a foul.
Nice play by Powers, the freshman. He got the ball. He wanted to go up, but the path was blocked by Kleine and by Gilpin, and he alertly gave it up and drew the foul.
And the foul's going to be called on Kevin Browning. That's just his first, but what a second half he has had. 13 second half points.
Well, Browning's a good athlete. He's a competitor, and you know he's got his right frame of mind mentally because he struggled the first half, but he came back very strong the second half. He's been a key in Mount Vernon's second half push.
Coaches are doing what they need to do at this point. They're taking their timeouts. They want to make sure they make no mistakes. And there's no mistake about this basketball game. 70-69, 2:05 remaining. And the second half story has to be Kevin Browning. Second half story has to be that Richmond continues to do it from all over the place. They've got their guys working, but Chad Kleine also adding in some quality points too.
Well, Mount Vernon has gotten some offense. Like I said, from Kevin Browning, I said he would have to step up. Roger Huffman's got 12 points all from the line. Free throws loom very large for Mount Vernon in this basketball game. You got 12 points from Huffman. You got 13 from Browning in the second half. Alex Schenk got 6 the first half to help keep him in it. Kleine and Gilpin now have combined, I think, for 34 points between them. So everybody is doing the job for Mount Vernon. You know, they're a balanced ball club. They had 3 people in double figures, almost 4. Richmond's doing their thing, and both teams are doing what they do well, and that's why we almost have a tie ball game at 70-69. Both teams going right down to the wire with what they do best, and it's just a question. This could be a basketball game where whoever wins is the one that has the ball last.
We will look for that. But Jared Powers will have the ball right now from the line, and he's hit his only attempt at the line today. This is his second. Rebound, Mount Vernon. Aaron pass, turnover. Long pass, Kevin Browning. Jimmy Howell doesn't even say anything. Kevin knows. Kevin says, don't worry, coach. I got 154 to make up for that one.
Yeah, that was a costly turnover there. Kevin Newberry, he was going to bring it across, and he probably could have brought it across. And then he looked up and saw the open man, and he got caught in between. He got that in-between thing. Either do one thing or the other. Don't hesitate.
Richmond by one, 148. Brad Wright. Listen to the crowd. Wright is stripped by Kleine. Loose ball. And a foul.
That's 5 on Brad Wright.
Good night, Brad Wright. You see it.
And he looked over at George Griffith, said, I didn't touch him. Gilpin's going to go to the foul line, and we've said it before, and we'll say it now, and I'm sure we'll say it again. Most ball games come down to taking care of the basketball and getting those free throws. And Gilpin's up at the line, and these free throws loom very large with 1:38 to go.
Gilpin gets the first to go. Gilpin's got 15 points.
as Brad Wright can only be a spectator from this point in. Gilpin 4-5 from the line, 71-70. Listen to the crowd.
Now the Richmond followers and the Mount Vernon Marauder followers all on their feet right now. Nobody in their sections are sitting down.
Chad Austin. Frazier for three. Yes! Back to a two-point Richmond lead. Look at the pressure. Klein needs somebody. Find Huffman. Huffman pushes it up. Gives it over. Browning back up. Loose ball. Klein gets. Richmond finally gets it. Gilpin, but he's fouled.
Well, some hectic action there on the offensive end. Mount Vernon kept the ball alive. That was the key. They kept the ball alive and finally got a good position there by Gilpin.
Here's the foul.
Here's Gilpin inside to your left. Nice shovel pass by Alex Shank. Powers moved up into him with the body. He was there first, but he didn't hold his ground. He moved into him with the body. Good call by the referee. And Gilpin, who just dropped in a couple of free throws at the 138 mark, goes there again with 57 seconds to go. And Richmond's going to ice the free throw shooter. They're going to take a timeout.
Yeah, we'll take a timeout ourselves. We need the breather here with 57 seconds left. It is a two-point basketball game. Gilpin's at the line for Mount Vernon to try to even it up. 73-71. We'll be back for that fantastic finish after this short timeout. High school basketball here on TCB4. Folks, it's exciting here. The numbers and the pictures tell the story.
Well, it's a tall story right now. It's Brian Gilpin, 6'11 at the free throw line. He's done a good job today at the line. He just knocked in two with 1:38 to go.
Knocks one in with 57 seconds to go. 5 of 6 from the line is Brian Gilpin, 1-point ball game. In and out. Richmond leads by one. They have the ball. Great strip by Wright. Vernon has the ball. What ball control by them. And then to Kleine, the big man, yes!
Excellent pass by Kevin Browning into Chad Kleine.
30 seconds remain. Richmond trails by one. Will they work for the last shot or will they try to tie right away? They'll try to tie. Rebound Richmond. Back up. Short. Mount Vernon basketball.
There's the shot from the baseline. It won't go in and out. Powers gets the rebound. Turns. It wouldn't go. It had a little tip from Brian Gilpin. He either tipped or altered that shot. It went out of bounds off Richmond. To Mount Vernon, you see Jimmy Howe's reaction. A controlled, pretty controlled coach here, I'd say, right there for that situation.
That's because he was saying, get a T.O., baby. Come over here. Let's talk about what we're going to do with the ball.
Well, this game's everything we thought it would be, Mike and Moore. This basketball, and you can bet that Richmond's going to be all over him everywhere. And this will be a curious situation before they try to have Roger Huffman beat the press every time. And this time they're going to be jumping him, so the outlet people are going to be really important. We'll see when they come out how they're going to set up out of bounds, who the trigger man will be. They can always bring Gilpin up in the middle and go high to him, but we'll see what they're going to do. Huffman's going to be the trigger man, hopefully to get it in and maybe get it back. Gilpin is at midcourt. See Gilpin at midcourt. He's got some company back there.
Richmond lives and dies by the press. They can stay alive with it if it's successful. Inbounds to Kleine. He's got it. And they foul the big man.
Pretty smart play there. They got it into a big man. They could get the ball up and over, and then Kleine just buried the basketball. And with the time on the clock, he knew that they had to stop that clock. They used up 3 seconds in doing so, and he drew the foul.
Foul coming from Chad Austin.
Uh,
Well, would it be safe to say these are the most important free throws of Chad Kleine's life that he'll have a minute or so to think about?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if they're the most important, but there can't be any others that were more important, I don't think. He's a 78% free throw shooter, so...
And he hasn't missed from the line tonight. He'll try to ice it, or at least put him up by three. 10 seconds remain. We'll take a quick timeout here on TTV4. Jimmy Howell can't even look. George Griffin looks on with anticipation. And Kleine hits it.
Well, the story, Mike, right now, Kleine at the line.
Trying to bring it up by three. But 10 seconds remain. Richmond can hit the tray. They just need two. Watch the clock, folks. They miss it and turn it over. No, they don't. They keep it. A lot of Richmond people.
It went off Brian Gilpin out of bounds. It went off the Richmond player and then off of Gilpin. Gilpin couldn't quite get the handle. So 6 seconds, Richmond's going to inbounds under their own basket.
Could it be OT here at the Hinkle Fieldhouse?
The block by Kleine, the steal by Huffman, and it's over.
We'll be right back here on TTV4. The finals are set. Brebeuf and Mount Vernon. This is high school basketball on TTV4. Mount Vernon is in. They'll meet the Brebeuf Braves. They win today 75-73 over the Richmond Red Devils. Backcourt side along with Kerry Donna. We're here with the winning coach of the Mount Vernon Marauders, Jimmy Holland. Jimmy, you said on Monday when you were here for the meeting, if it's in the 70s, that's good for us. It ended up just 2 points good enough.
Yeah, I did. I was concerned how high the score was, really, but we had to attack the press some, and they got out of passing lanes, and our other kids stepped in and got some good shots against our half-court defense.
Jimmy, I know everybody hears about Kleine and Gilpin, the Twin Towers, but I thought in the second half, Kevin Browning was a real big key.
Yes, he was. He did a good job defensively. He cut into that paint, and he's very good when he gets the ball inside the paint because he can jump up over people and score.
And Mike, what about the Roadrunner, Mr. Huffman?
Yeah, the Huffman man, he did it real nicely. And you talked to him earlier. You said, go ahead and do what you do best. Go ahead and control the ball, dribble the ball. He had a tough task out there with the Richmond Red Devils.
Yeah, yes, he did. He was playing against five kids as quick as he was at one time, but he can handle the ball awfully well, and he got the ball into some scorers' hands late in the game.
And you had your big men come through, too, and, you know, Gilpin and Kleine, they were certainly gems, and they're gems, and you love having them in your jerseys, don't you?
No question about it. We had all six people really contribute a great deal at times today.
And also, Chris White, I got to point out, he... tough shot down at the end, but he went back on the defensive end and made a very, very big deflection for a steal.
Yes, he did. He came up from behind. This group of kids doesn't give up, and that's what we've tried to stress. They've had it ever since they were third and fourth graders, that they're determined to get to the Final Four, and that's what we're after tonight.
Jimmy, last question. I know you're excited. I know you want to think about this victory, but think for a second about Allen Henderson and Brebeuf for it.
Well, he's a great player. You know, not too many teams in the state have gotten to play against both of the two best players in the state, and we're going to be able to do that. So, you know, we've got to control him, but their other people are very good. They play roles very well, and they can jump up and shoot the ball.
Jimmy Howell, congratulations. We'll see you tonight, 8 o'clock, right here on TTV4. Jimmy Howell, the Mount Vernon Marauders, victorious here. Gary, let's talk a little bit about tonight as he goes in and enjoys his kids, and that's exactly what he should do tonight. Real quickly, we got about 30 seconds. Talk about what we'll see.
Well, we'll see Mount Vernon doing what they do. They're a team. You know, all the kids, he said six men did the job. And I think a key tonight, Brebeuf moves forward today with their forwards. Allen Henderson, if they Mount Vernon packs it in and they're able to take Allen out of the game offensively like Shelbyville did, then those forwards, Courtney, Winters, Gordon, Roberts, they're going to have to do the job.
And we'll see how healthy Allen Henderson is, and we'll see all you for this telecast tonight. The final again in game two, Mount Vernon, 75-73 victor over the Richmond Red Devils. IHSAA tournament action is brought to you by... Marsh, we value you. By Scott's, a great lawn or your money back. And by McDonald's, food, folks, and fun.
again. Here's your matchup for tonight. The number four team in the state, the Brebeuf Braves at 20-6 against Mount Vernon Jimmy Hall and the Mount Vernon Marauders, 8 o'clock here on TTV4.